But ladies and gentlemen, this stage is different. You get an excellent program, you have the best band in the world, but ladies and gentlemen, you have to provide some energy. It's very simple physics, ninth grade, maybe eighth grade, you know that energy won't disappear. We do something energetic on stage, it comes to you. Now you have to give it back to us, otherwise it wouldn't work. So, ladies and gentlemen, we do it again. I get off stage, I'll come back, and you all know what to do. Did I make myself clear? Thank you very much. Just a second. Thank you very much. Great having you here. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you for being back to the experience. Ladies and gentlemen, we do have the best photographer in the world. We'd like to do a picture for DMX Co. I need your help. I would like you all to raise your hands. Have you ever seen like how deaf people applaud? They do it like this. Please raise your hands. We would like to have the best picture in the world. Please raise your hand. Come on, everybody. Raise your hands. All right. And now we do the picture. Come on. And let's scream. Let me scream. Like, yeah. All right. This is DMX Co. This experience. Oh, thank you very much. Coming to our next topic, ladies and gentlemen, we would like to talk about design. You know, technology is very important. We know interactive installations, immersive media, experimental storytelling, new products, but technology without design is something different. So how to use design and technology to create new experience? I have a great panel, ladies and gentlemen. Please treat them like rock stars because they are rock stars. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a big hand for Yves Peitzner, co-founder of TISH. But there's Malte Gammeljan, please. She is so smart. She is so amazing, ladies and gentlemen. Please welcome Jelena, Gregov, co-founder of TISH. Ladies and gentlemen, another bright young man. He was the winner of the World Changing Ideas of 2019 from Fast Company, ladies and gentlemen. Please welcome the one and only Max Julian Fischer. But there's more to come, ladies and gentlemen. Please welcome Max Hurler. He's a partner of Jost Hurler Group, ladies and gentlemen. Please welcome him. And ladies and gentlemen, this panel, we needed something very special to host that very panel. We looked hard all over the world, ladies and gentlemen, and we found a guy, not just a guy, we found the guy to host that panel. Please, ladies and gentlemen, please give him a big welcome to Chris Denson.
Good afternoon, everyone. Wow. Good afternoon, everyone. All right. I'm excited to chat with these guys about design and creativity and all the awesome things they're up to. Max, can I start with you?
Sure, please.
For some reason, you decided to create a hearing aid that looks like jewelry.
Yes.
You don't seem to have it'd be hard of hearing yourself. I want to talk a little bit about the concept of empathy, right? I think empathy goes a lot into design and designed experiences. How did you go about developing a sense of empathy for this particular project? And we're going to show a little bit of it for you guys so you can see it. But how did that work out for you?
Yes, so the project started actually that my grandma is hard of hearing, and I tried to convince her, like, why don't you wear a hearing aid? And I got into the hearing aid market, and you have very technological driven products. So you have a hearing aid which can translate into 26 languages. And if we look at the voice user interface, it becomes a really interesting product. But if we see regular hearing aids on the market right now, then you can see that the design, maybe there's, okay.
we
regular hearing aids are, the product is always, you try to hide it. So the concept or the design is always as little as possible. And still you have this big stigma linked to hearing aids. So there, I came up with the idea, why not get...
There we go.
I think it's over there. Okay.
I'm clicking, so...
Okay, sorry. Get used to the technique here. When we talk about empathy, I think it's just stepping into the shoes of the customer, like going into a hearing aid acoustician, and it's always in the back, and it's not this fancy like glasses product. So this is the design we came up with. And yeah, that's what it's about.
Jelena, thank you.
Yeah.
And congratulations on your Fast Company nod. That's
thank you.
Pretty amazing. One more thank time you. For Max and his Fast Company nod.
Thank you.
Jelena, you seem to be quite curious about the human condition. Talk to us a little bit about empathy for you, for your work, and also your own personal passion for like understanding sort of human design thinking.
Right. So I guess it's kind of redundant to say that empathy is important in our work because, after all, what we do is communication, which is like the foundation of the society. there's a lot of research that goes into creating an experiential piece. What I'm very passionate about is figuring out, especially in this day and age where the technological innovations are moving at a very fast pace, and we're so preoccupied with either smartphones or any other screens that surround us in our environment. What I'm very passionate about is finding the ways how to use technology to enhance storytelling, which to put it down most simply means how to use technology to as a communication device, like when talking to audiences, which is not like one-on-one communication. So a lot of times that has to do with using immersion as a vehicle for contemplation, or whether it's, again, depending on the specific, business needs that business objectives that we're trying to solve and accomplish. Pretty much like that.
No, there's an interesting word that comes up in this panel, which is storytelling, and you just used it. And other Max, Maximilian, from a real estate side of things, storytelling doesn't necessarily resonate naturally with real estate. But talk to us a little bit about your ideas behind story, and applying that to a business that really typically doesn't get that word associated with it.
Exactly, because usually when you think real estate, you think of concrete material, steel, glass, brick, mortar, etc. But when you're in this field, actually, you do have a high responsibility, because what you're actually doing is you create frameworks for human activities. And the better these frameworks get, the better life also becomes in these particular spaces. Because we believe that we have one enemy, which is time. And it's a great thing if you get the best out of your time. And so we try to create spaces where you make the best out of your time. And so we try to activate these spaces before they actually become popular. For example, through collaborations with TISH, through art, through experiential design, bringing in people who share experiences. And then afterwards, had a good time and talk about it.
Yeah, we'll take a look at a video of yours in a second, especially from a collaborative standpoint. Yves, I think, mentioning the relationship between TISH and Hurler, talk to us a little bit about translating a client's vision into a reality, right? It all starts with conversation and words, and then it becomes this big immersive experience, but there's a road of getting from point A to point Z, I guess. But talk to us a little bit about that translation mechanism that happens along the way.
Right. I mean, usually we talk to the clients like we did here also in forms of like a discovery workshop in a sense. So we really are in one level to when we just, you know, when we create a briefing, what is it the client wants to achieve? What is the message? What, you know, there's so many different ways we, you know, could communicate with an experiential piece. So that is, you know, something which we nail down in the first place, which what is the initial message of this, basically. And
if I may add something.
Was that? Yes, you may.
A lot of times we have clients saying, coming to us and saying, can you make us look cool? Like, we want to be like as closer as we can to this like technological, whatever it is, pushing the envelope kind of area. I'm like, okay, let's unpack that and see like how you can use technology to help you get there, like whether it's like, so to get a step back, like mostly it's our clients are tech companies, but then there's a lot of clients who want to be perceived as innovative, and that's where they use technology.
Well, I love that, because you know, yes, you can talk to a company and talk to, you know, a group of people, but also in your experience, it's like it started with one, one human being. Was there resistance with your grandmother going like, oh no, I'm fine with this, or like, you know, I'm sure there was a little bit of like tension there. Like, what was that? How did you manage that?
Yeah, there was a lot of tension, of course, and the difficulty.
Your grandmother still loves you, yes?
I think so.
Okay, good.
So.
All right, just
grandma. Yeah, I think so. Still, she doesn't wear the thing right now, so it's not published yet. But of course, yeah, you have a product which is always hidden, and then you try to make it break this stigma. There's a big thing between vision and then execution. So, yeah.
I'm going to try to show a video really quickly, and I hope you guys enjoy it. We're going to show a few seconds of it. Echo. Everyone say echo. Thank you. You win a prize at the end of this. This is a really interesting project, but again, between this client and service provider relationship. Can you guys walk us through what we just witnessed?
Are you going to do it?
Yeah. So we collaborated on this project together because Maximilian asked us to help him to, because they are collaborating with, it's called the Lange Nacht der Museen in Munich, which is a long night of the museums, which is almost pretty, every German city has that, where museums are open for very long and all night long, and you can visit them. And Schwabinger Tor, which is the development there, participated in this long night of the museum, having their underground car park as exhibition space, which is kind of unusual, and Maximilian will sure tell us why and so on. I'll just talk about the project quickly. So what we use the architecture of the underground car park, rather than having it as a gallery space and sense of showing pictures and stuff like that, we use the space to make a one big installation out of it. And the idea was to, it's called Digital Echo, and the idea was that you speak in this microphone, and then you walk through this big garage, which was about 250 meters long, and what you spoke into the microphone gets transformed into light and sound, and on each columns we would have speakers and lights, and the sound would travel with the light through the garage, and it would go faster and faster and faster, and kind of go out of control until somebody else spoke into the microphone. So this was also an analogy to social media. So basically, you know, whenever you post something or you send out a message, at one point it gets uncontrollable, and you know, that was a kind of analog to this or the metaphor to this spatial experience, basically.
And what I liked about that project was that, to your point, it's reminiscent of social media behavior, but it's in a physical space. So like, how are we translating that into a physical space? And I guess, Max, for you, is business goals, right? These big immersive environments and these kind of sort of crazy ideas are beautifully executed, but then at the end of the day, you have a business that you're operating. So where does the creativity match the business goal?
I don't think that the two are mutually exclusive. And also from our point of view, this was really a lot of fun. We believe people in general, they always have and they always will love art. And at that time, the project hasn't really been completed. It was halfway done. It wasn't what we call popular now. It wasn't rented out. And we thought it would be a good thing to collaborate with the long night of the museums in Munich, pretty much a night where the museums stay up all night and there are bus tours and everything. And we used the half completed garage as a museum to deliver an experience that is new, that is fun, that is interactive, where people meet and share their experience afterwards. If they talk about the site afterwards, of course we wouldn't have a problem with it. But it wasn't there wasn't like a commercial number that we needed to target in order for this to be successful.
Right? Well, I think there's a difference between sort of brand metrics and brand experience, right? And I think the brand experience actually draws a closer emotional connection to whatever that business is. And in your case, you know, you're building community. You want to provide experiences for the community.
Exactly. The location is actually just adjacent to a very popular neighborhood, but it is next to it. It's not within it. And our aim was to incorporate, to include it in this lively, diverse neighborhood that has been a habitat for artists and art lovers for a long time.
Talk to me, anybody, please talk to me. About the art of the pitch, right? I think a lot of times as innovators, we kind of talk with our hands and it's going to do this and the lights will flash and there's an AR component. How do you get people to feel and really understand what your vision is and communicate it in a way that you actually get to do it?
Well, I could talk a little bit about that because so we're based in Munich now, but before I came to Munich, I was an experiential strategist working at the New York Times, and we were pitching a lot, like really a lot. But what was most important there was to establish a lot of things in the beginning in terms of like, is there a strategically important location that we need to consider? What about the emotions? What kind of emotions do we need to evoke? And then we would always go back during the process and like at the pitch day, during the presentation, you always go back to that the first moments where we establish some really important parameters. However, still, there are a lot of moments where it's difficult for clients to imagine what exactly is going to happen inside a space, which is what has been proven very useful for us was using virtual reality. So we would build a space and then present it to a client in VR. That's where they had this emotional moment. Most of the times, if we'd done our job well.
A good emotion, I hope.
Yeah. Well, yeah. So that was really helpful for us and for the clients.
Yeah. Along those lines, what are you guys looking forward to in terms of other trends that you want to take advantage of in spaces, in the businesses that you're creating? You know, what are some things that you're looking at that are a little bit more future forward that you are excited to leverage?
Well, we work with technology, but we're not obsessed with technology in terms of it doesn't define what the experience is going to be like. So we're mostly interested in the human behavior and how people are like gathering around ideas. That's where we always look for inspiration. I don't care, is it VR or AR or what's the next shiny thing? It's totally irrelevant. What's relevant is how us humans think and feel and behave about something.
Are there any sort of data points that we miss along the way? Because I think, you know, at an ad tech kind of primarily sort of gathering, we're thinking about data in a very different way. But there's sort of these emotional sentiments, these other cues, foot traffic in a space, or a collective emotional sentiment. How does that come into play? You know, I'll start with you, Max, as well on that answer. Just how are you thinking about other data points that are maybe non-traditional from other ad tech spaces?
Important to us is whatever makes life better in general. So the things that we really pay attention to is how can life, or how we're an urban developer. So how can life in the cities be even be better in the future? And no matter the technology or the data, this is what we look at.
That's great. And then finally, on this note of trust, right? Trust in you. You know, I think when there's this creative edge that you have, how do you develop the sense of trust? And Max, especially kind of fresh out of school, you know, but having a project that's really strong to enter the workforce with, how do you get people to trust your vision as you move forward into the world?
I think it's the person. Like, also when it comes to pitching, I believe that there's a quote which is like, as long as you can't eat pizza or drink a beer during an online meeting, you won't build up trust somehow. And what I experienced so far in my pitch is that only when you get this direct physical connection, then you can build up trust. That's to me what I experienced in my after graduation life so far.
Yves, same sort of question. What, as far as trust, like how does that come up in your day-to-day and how you approach your work?
You mean trust to the clients or trust to
In either sense, whatever comes to mind first.
All right. I mean, I trust in people, actually. And that's why I do this job, actually, because, you know, we create interactive installations, spatial stuff. So basically people interact with it and you just don't know. You always have a purpose. You always think of something that people do with this, but it's absolutely unforeseeable what people are very creative, and it's something you cannot think of, you know, how people then engage with your installation. I think that's what for me is wonderful about what we do, and that's why I trust in people to do something else with it than I thought of or we thought of.
He's hopelessly optimistic.
But he should be, though.
But to your point, like when it comes to trust, I think the return on investment is like a keyword that's always like circling around it. But so there are always two types of clients. There's on one side clients who are like, I don't care about it. This is purely creative endeavor that I want to do because I want to build a community. And then there's clients who want to, who are only care about legacy or like what comes afterwards. Is it user generated content? Is it press that we generate? So that's when we can measure things. But on this side, we actually don't, and we don't
care. How many jaws dropped?
That's kind of exactly.
Back, same question.
Same.
Trust.
What we're into is really people business. So and a lot of people trust us, and that is the ultimate. You need to keep the promises that you make, whether to the tenants that you're presenting your project to, whether it's the banks, whether it's the city authorities, and especially the community that you're making these promises to.
Yeah, it's one of the things that I like to focus on is the idea that every brand makes an emotional promise of some sort, right? Whatever your motto or your tagline is, it's making an emotional promise. So how many times can you amplify and deliver on that promise, and how many different ways can you do it on? Well, on that note, thank you all for being here. Wonderful round of applause
thank
for
you.
These amazing individuals. Thank you.